Our first speaker this evening is Dr. Stephen Wright. Stephen is a relatively new addition to our faculty. Stephen is a Canadian research chair in social psychology at the university. He comes to us most recently from the University of California at Santa Cruz, and it wasn't scenic enough there for him, so he decided to come here to Vancouver. Stephen did his graduate work at McGill University, and he is a world authority on issues in social psychology, particularly intergroup relations and issues of studying group membership and various other aspects of social psychology. So with that,
hi, it's really a great pleasure to be here today. It's always nice to talk to people outside of the normal academic people that we talk to, which are either usually our close colleagues who know exactly what we're doing, and because we're at conferences and it's always the same faces that we know, or it's great groups of students who are also, by the very nature of the business, have to sit and listen and talk to us. That's their job. So it's nice to talk to some folks differently. I just finished teaching a very large social psych class to a big group of second year students. So I feel like I'm kind of right in the lecture mode for social psychology. So I hope you, if I start appearing too much like an intro to social psychology prof, somebody will wave and say, you know, give us some more details. But hopefully I'll give you enough that you can find a little bit about what we do in social psychology generally, but more specifically about my own area of research and my own interests in intergroup relations, and particularly in the topic of prejudice. But to give you a little background, just what social psychology is. Social psychology is a part of the psychology discipline, and therefore it is a scientific study, as you've probably heard throughout these talks, that we focus on the particularly on the scientific method. But in the case of social psychology, we're looking at how our social environments, how the people around us and the social environments that we create and through our institutions affect our thoughts and our emotions and our actions. So when people get together, when relationships happen, when people are interacting one with another, we're in the realm now of social psychology. We're thinking about how people's thoughts and emotions and actions are influenced by others. Social psychology takes very seriously the idea that we are social animals, that who we are and what we do and how we think is very much involved with the other people around us. In fact, there's good evidence to show that we spend a great portion of our time thinking about our relationships, thinking about the people that we interact with, and worrying about how we are structuring and building those interactions, monitoring our own behavior and the behavior of others so that we fit in, so that we can express ourselves in ways that we want other people to see, and so on. So we are truly social animals. Research in social psychology has shown that relationships with others and with groups influence not only how we think and act, but in fact who we are. The very construction of the self is a social project whereby we interact with other people to produce who we are today. At SFU, our focus in social psychology primarily is around the area of intergroup relations and interpersonal relations. We've really sort of focused, a number of our faculty members are very interested in how relationships specifically are formed and how they influence our thoughts and actions. But also we have a special interest in the ways that social psychology can help us to understand important social issues, and also to understand how we can make application to those issues to change the world and solve relevant social problems, whether those be involving interpersonal interactions or whether they involve intergroup interactions. We also have interest in things like health psychology. A number of faculty who have focused interests on how social psychology applies to actions related to health. My own research and my own interests have to do with intergroup relations. And this is specifically when social psychology becomes groupy, when we're interested in the me becoming we and the you becoming them. And so we're now looking at how our group memberships influence our thoughts and actions and our interactions with others. And one of the critical areas, or one of the major areas that social psychology is studied in intergroup relations, is the area of prejudice. So I thought quickly I'll give you a couple of definitions and then we'll move on to some more interesting things. When we talk about prejudice, the term is used, of course, all the time in public speech and so on. But when we talk about it, we talk about it specifically as an evaluation. Prejudice is based on negative prejudice is based on a negative evaluation of another group, simply because, and its members, simply because people belong to that group. So it involves beliefs, perhaps negative beliefs about the character of that group, as well as negative emotions. Things like anger, fear, and distrust are often, and disgust are often part of what we would call prejudiced attitudes or prejudiced evaluations. I want to distinguish that from discrimination, which is an act or a behavior or anything that results in actual outcome differences between groups. So prejudice is housed in the heads of people. It's thoughts and ideas that are based on groups. Discrimination is action, when people actually work to change, to create a situation or to directly influence the outcomes for groups. And in this case, we're talking about influencing those outcomes so that one group does better than the other. My group is better than yours. Prejudice, whenever I talk first about prejudice, people say, well, you know, that was really bad, it used to be really bad, but now maybe, you know, prejudice isn't really a problem anymore, maybe we're past all that. Well, there is actually some very good news, all of the recent evidence, and certainly this, it's been a clear progression. We've had bumps in the roads, but there's been a clear progression over the last 50 or 60 years, such that it really does appear that North American societies have made enormous strides in improving intergroup attitudes, that laws and policies that have been made at all levels of government have expressly and specifically moved to make direct acts of discrimination illegal. Most people now see expressions of open prejudice as unacceptable. Most people don't agree that we should be saying things like that anymore. Surveys show that a steady decline in the number of people in both in the US and Canada that endorse blatantly prejudiced or racist ideas or blatantly sexist ideas. So we see a decline in people's expressions of these ideas. But does that mean that prejudice is dead or that it's dying? And a social psychological analysis of prejudice tells us that we're probably premature in thinking that this is the case. I think it doesn't take a wise person to realize that there's still a substantial subsection of the population that carries on with obvious old-fashioned prejudiced ideas. And very often these expressions can be found amongst people who feel like they're in safe places where they can talk openly about their attitudes about other groups. And usually they involve the groups that are most demeaned and most devalued in our institutions as well, where people feel safe expressing directly negative attitudes about members of that group. But what I want to talk today about is more about what I'm going to call the modern form of prejudice. Prejudice, instead of thinking of discrimination as the inevitable outcome of people thinking negatively and acting negatively towards people in an overt and kind of obvious way, what I want to talk about is ways that prejudice has become less overt, less obvious, maybe even so unobvious that it's not obvious to us ourselves. I want to talk about how prejudice has become more hidden. What we find is that many people will only express their true beliefs, as I mentioned before, in places where they feel like they're anonymous or they're safe. Simply by making a questionnaire anonymous, we find more negative attitudes expressed than if someone's asked to express those, or if the group is asked to express those attitudes publicly. So if we ask people to publicly tell us what they think about a particular other ethnic group, we get very different responses than if they think they're filling out an anonymous survey and nobody will ever know what they say. So modern prejudice is hidden from public view. But not only that, it's more subtle. Not only is our true feelings, sometimes we hide them and we don't tell others, but also many of the ways in which we act upon those prejudices and many of the ways those prejudices are expressed have become much more subtle and less obvious, even when they are expressed directly. It's not always clear, was that prejudice? And so when we talk to people from groups that are the target of prejudice, there's a sense of ambiguity, of uncertainty. Was that really prejudice or was it really something else? Because the modern forms tend to be much less obvious, much less explicit. But I also want to talk about something called unconscious prejudice. One of the things that we as social psychologists know is that all of our attitudes, not just about other groups and not just about other people, have a residual component that's actually below our own level of awareness. That our attitudes influence our behavior and our thoughts before we can even actually control them. And these unconscious thoughts can be quite negative, even though our expressed in person and available thoughts can be quite positive. And I want to talk about that as well. So that negative attitudes can even be hidden from ourselves. And we have some ways of digging those out. Let me give you a couple of examples of some research, lines of research that have looked at more subtle forms of prejudice. One of the earliest ways of sort of demonstrating more subtle forms of social prejudice was simply by instead of asking people to express negative attitudes, which people are very reluctant to do now, they're very unlikely to say that they hate or they dislike or that some other group is bad.
But instead, we ask questions about whether their willingness to ascribe positive things to that group. How much do they admire and respect, have compassion for that group, relative to their own group? And what we find is, though most people do not express negative feelings towards other groups, and most of our survey work, people are far more likely to withhold the positive kinds of feelings towards the other group. So they're less likely to say that they feel admiration and respect for other groups than they are to say that about their own group. So just one of the examples of a kind of more subtle form. Instead of expressing directly negative attitudes about another group, we withhold the more positive feelings like compassion, admiration, and respect. Let me give you another quick example. This one's got a long and fancy name. We psychologists tend to like to do this. But all this, this is called infrahumanization. And all it means is that we tend to see people from other groups, especially groups that we may feel in some kind of conflict with, as just a little less human than us. And one of the most interesting ways is to look at something, at the way people perceive other people's emotions. So we're well aware that other people have emotions and that they have the same kinds of emotional experiences as we do. But we often find different ways of looking at those emotions, and we ascribe different levels to which people can feel those emotions. And one of the interesting cases is this distinction between two types of emotions. There seems to be this set of primary emotions, things like hatred, fear, anger, pleasure, those kinds of emotions which we at least believe that we share with other animals. For example, we believe our dog can feel fear, and maybe the chimpanzee can feel attraction or pleasure. But the second kind of emotion, the secondary emotions, things like love and guilt, humiliation, grief, and hope, we tend to think of those as more uniquely human, that these are what make us different from the animals. We can experience these secondary kinds of emotions. Now, that may be actually a form of prejudice against animals, by the way. But certainly there is a sense by which we believe these to be the uniquely sort of human emotions, the ones that make us special and unique. Well, interestingly, a whole variety of studies now have shown that especially groups that are devalued in society or groups that are thought to be in negative ways, we find that when we ask people about that group's ability to express primary emotions or feel primary emotions, we see no differences. Our group and the other group experience these emotions the same way. The primary emotions like anger and fear, we both feel them. But the secondary emotions, the ones that make us uniquely human, we think those are a little bit more likely to be felt by members of our own group. And we can see this sometimes in the representations of in the popular media. Somehow we're led to believe that we experience the pain of a loss of a loved one, or we experience the tragedy of death more acutely than they do. They somehow don't really feel as hurt by the loss of a child or the death of a family member. The kinds of things like grief. So what they feel is fear or anger, but we feel is grief and pain and sorrow and so on, these more human emotions. So at least to some degree, there's evidence that shows that one of the ways that we have subtly think more positively about our own group than the other is we hold on to those primary or those secondary human emotions a little bit tighter for our own group than we are willing to give them to others. But my favorite example of this kind of more subtle forms of prejudice comes in what I call excuses, excuses, excuses. When we can justify our discriminatory behavior with some other way, other than prejudice, then all of a sudden we start to see even those who claim on relatively basic surveys to not to be prejudiced to show dramatically different effects. Let me show you an example. This was a study that I did with an honors student at Santa Cruz. It was a replication of an earlier study done with African Americans and whites. We brought white students into the lab. And they were sitting in a waiting room, assumedly waiting to go into the actual study. And as they were waiting, the experimenter for the study came out with a clipboard and looking very much like an experimenter. And the experimenter, we had two experimenters. One of them was a Latino woman, a Mexican-American woman, and one was a white woman, European-American woman. And each of the subjects got only one of those experimenters. They either were faced with a Latino Mexican-American woman or a white European-American woman. But also, we manipulated the situation so that there was either two other people there or not. And these two other people looked like other subjects. They were waiting, and the experimenter talked to them as well. But in fact, they were helpers in our study. So the person arrives, and they're either alone in a room, and they're met by either a white or a Latino experimenter, or they're sitting with two other white students waiting, and they meet a Latino or a white experimenter. And here's what we found. So we've got The target up there is the experimenter. We've got a Mexican-American experimenter or a white experimenter, and we've got our participants either here alone or our participants are waiting with two other bystanders, white bystanders. The experimenter talks to them. Oops, I don't want to show you that yet. The experimenter talks to them and then says, I'll be right back. I just have to get something. Goes around the corner into another room, and as she goes around the corner, we have it rigged, so there's a big pile of things, and she knocks some things over, makes a noise like she's fallen down, and then sits down on the ground. The person can't see them because she's gone around the corner, but they can clearly hear the crashing sound of things falling and the sound of someone going, ugh, as they fall on the ground. The question that we ask is, what percentage of these people who are sitting in this waiting room and have just heard this young woman fall down will jump up and run around to see if she's okay and come and help her? So our dependent variable, or the thing that we're measuring here, is what percentage of people will actually jump out of their chair and run around and try and help this woman who's apparently fallen down in the other room? This is our helping behavior. And what we find is, when the participant is by themselves, all by themselves, we get a very high level of helping. Over 3/4 of people go and help the woman that's fallen down around the corner. And in fact, they're even a little more likely to go and help if the person is a Latino woman. Remember, these are all white students. So they're helping the member of the other group a little bit more than they're helping their own group. This clearly doesn't look like prejudice. But what happens when there's two other white bystanders and they both sit there like nothing's happened? So you imagine yourself in this study, you're sitting there, you're looking around, and there's these two people, they're not doing anything. Somebody just fell down and they're not doing anything. Should I go help or shouldn't I go help? It's a little harder to go help when two other people aren't doing anything. And what happens then? Then we see, first of all, people are less likely to help when two other people don't. That's an interesting piece of information from social psychology called the bystander effect. But look who gets the most of the bystander effect. Now the Mexican-American woman is about half as likely to get help as a white woman. When there's an excuse, I got two people that are not doing anything. Maybe she doesn't need my help. Maybe it isn't that important. So we see a dramatic difference in people's behavior when there's excuse for not helping, or at least there seems to be a good reason not to help. But not only do they help less, they help less specifically towards the outgroup member, the member of another ethnic group. Let me give you another example. This is a study that I wasn't involved with, but it was done by a colleague of mine, Jack DeVideo, and his colleagues. The people were in a mock jury situation. Participants are all pretending to be in a jury. They're listening to a story about a violent crime, and they're led to believe that the perpetrator is either black or white. So there's either a black or a white defendant. That's the target up there. They're given information about the trial, and during this information that they're given, they're told a piece of evidence that's pretty darn incriminating. It looks like this. With this evidence, it pretty much looks like the person did it. It's eyewitness testimony. But they're very quickly told that that piece of information, in one condition, they're very quickly told that that piece of information is inadmissible. The judge tells them that you can't use that piece of information, it was illegally obtained, and therefore you can't use it. So that's the inadmissible evidence. In the other situation, they're not told that. They're just left with that information. So it looks pretty bad for our defendant, and our defendant is either black or white, but the damning information is either admissible or inadmissible. Well, when the information is admissible, most people convict. So this is the percentage of people that convict. About 3/4 of the people convict, so the evidence is pretty compelling. And we see no difference between a black and a white defendant. No prejudice at all here. When we've got damning evidence, our all white participants decide that black and whites should be punished equally. However, when they're given evidence and told not to use it, all of a sudden, they're very good at not using it when the defendant is white, when the defendant is from their own group. They're not so good at not using it when the defendant is black. So again, we see no prejudice at all when there's no excuses. All of a sudden, I've got this information I'm supposed to not listen to. It's a little easier to pretend and still use it when the person is a member of another group. So we see this is the kinds of subtle examples of prejudice where it sneaks out when we have excuses. So here, when there's no obvious justification for people to treat members of the two groups differently, we see no evidence of prejudice or no evidence of discriminatory behavior. However, when my negative actions can be justified by something other than prejudice, then members of the other group are more likely to be treated more harshly than members of my own group. And we find this, there's a whole bunch of other studies that show this with aggression studies, with a whole bunch of other examples where people are given justification for their negative treatment, and all of a sudden we see much more negative treatment of the out-group than the in-group. But it goes even further. Those are subtle examples where people's prejudice leak out in situations where they're... But sometimes the prejudices that we feel are not even available to ourselves. We aren't even aware of our own thoughts about other groups at some points. They sometimes our automatic thoughts come out and we experience them. They reach our conscious mind and we go, oh my God, did I think that? And we try and shut it down. I'm sure that many of you have had that experience. You said something or you thought something and you went, oh, I would never think that. Well, how could I have thought that? How could I say that? And we try and shut it out. That's where our unconscious or preconscious thoughts about a particular group may come forward. I'm going to talk a little bit about some examples of what this kind of automatic prejudice or what I'm going to call implicit prejudice. Prejudice below the level of conscious awareness. One of the kinds of ways that we've been studying this for quite a while now, and we're using this in our lab to do a whole bunch of different studies related to this issue of implicit prejudice, is a measure called the implicit association test. What this is a reaction time test in which people sit in front of a computer and they're exposed to a series of pictures and words, and I'll explain it in a little more detail. But essentially what it's looking at is our ability to very quickly, these are reaction time measures, so you're supposed to press the buttons as quickly as you possibly can, at speeds much faster than you could control consciously. It measures the speed at which a person associates different race faces with positive and negative words. So and I'm going to mention at the end that this has also been done with a whole bunch of other groups other than race, but the one we're going to talk about today are different racial groups. So let me give you how it works. Imagine you're in our study, you'd come and there'd be a computer screen, there's a bunch of information and a bunch of instructions, but you'd face a computer screen, and on the top of the screen for the critical trials are two groups, two ideas. One is the word bad or good on either side, and one is the name for a particular ethnic or racial group on the top. So in this case, we've got European paired with good and Asian paired with bad. And what you're told is you're going to see a series of words that are either good or bad, and you're going to see a series of faces that are either Asian or white, or Asian or European. And what you're supposed to do is when the good word comes up, you're supposed to press with your right hand and put it over onto that side. Or when a European face comes up, you're supposed to press it the right as well and put it over to that side. When a word that's bad comes up, you're supposed to press with your other hand and put it on the other side. And when an Asian face shows up, you're supposed to press with your other hand, and so on. So for example, and there's a little dot in the middle where you're supposed to focus, and so this word would come on, and very quickly you would see a bad word, so you should press with your left hand and get it over onto the other side. Of course, it would be much faster than that, and you'd be asked to we're measuring reaction time in less than a second here. Then you'd see a face, and if it's a European face, you'd pass for your right hand to move it onto that side. And then we'd continue, and there'd be a good word. And as you notice, halfway you do a whole bunch of these, and then we stop, take a break, and then we flip it over. And now you'll notice that Asian is over on the right-hand side with good, and European is over on the left-hand side with bad, and we go through a series of these again, a whole bunch of good and bad words, and a whole bunch of Asian and white faces in this particular example. The question then is, by taking all of these trials, dozens of times when people have been poking at the computer keys as fast as they can to match these up, the interesting thing then is, what is the association that's easiest for people to do? When their own group is paired with good, or when their own group is paired with bad, or when the other group is paired with good and the other group is paired with bad. We can tell whether it's easier for people to use the same finger to do me, us, and good than it is to do us and bad, versus them and good versus them and bad. And what we find is, using this, that people generally respond faster when their own group is paired with good than when the other group is paired with good, or vice versa. So the idea being is that it's easier for us to make responses to both words and faces when I have to put the good words and my group's face in the same place, and when I have to put the bad words and the other group's face in the other place. There's a bias towards the own to pairing one's own group with good words and a bias against pairing one's own group with bad words that leads to this general effect that we find here. So there's a tendency for us, in a very automatic way, remember these are measured in speeds that you couldn't possibly control consciously. The other interesting thing is that I'm going to talk about the variation for in a minute, but the other interesting thing about this is that the correlations between this implicit measure of prejudice and more explicit measures of prejudice measured by people's directly stated attitudes, vary dramatically. They can be very, very similar, and they can be very, very different. So people can hold very positive overt attitudes, explicit attitudes, stated attitudes, and yet score very high on this measure of implicit bias. And similarly, there can be cases where they're nice and close together, where people who are both negative on their explicit attitudes and on their implicit attitudes are both positive. So there's large variation. It's certainly not clear that what we feel and what we think in our conscious mind necessarily maps perfectly onto what goes on at this automatic or implicit level. That these two can be quite different. They can be have very different values. But there's also great differences in this tendency across people. So individual differences in people's demonstration of these implicit attitudes. We also see differences across target groups. As I mentioned, they now have implicit attitude tests for a whole variety of different groups. We've currently been using ones with a variety of different racial and ethnic groups. There are ones for women in mathematics, for example. There's ones on nationality and so on. So there's a variety of different groups. And the degree to which people show bias towards their own group depends on the group as well. And it also depends on situations. Even our unconscious thoughts are influenced by the situation in which we find ourselves. So for example, in some laboratories in the US where they were using the black-white IAT, they found that having a black experimenter changed people's implicit attitudes towards African Americans, even on this very quick reaction test. So situations also affect it. If you're interested in trying this out and you want to play some of these games, there's a website you can go to there that's set up by some people at Harvard that has a whole bunch of these IATs. Or you can, if you can't get that down, you can just, if you Google IAT, it's either the first or the second thing that comes up on the sheet. It's called the Implicit Association Test. And you can go and do as many as you like and find out how much you associate women with, or men with math and women not with math. There's an age one, how much do you associate old people with negatively valued words compared to young people and so on. So, but the other critical point is that implicit and explicit attitudes can be very different, as I mentioned before. There's a number of explanations for why even though, whoa, all of a sudden I'm going. Sorry about that. What was the fastest? There, I'm done. There's a number of reasons why that might happen, and one of them is that we've all been socialized in a society that provides us with information about about different groups. We also are constantly bombarded with reminders about those stereotypes and beliefs about those groups. Even though those implicit messages are being reinforced by what we read in the media, by what we see and what we hear our friends say, perhaps, and so on. So even though we may hold very positive attitudes in our own heads, our negative implicit attitudes are being reinforced by our society. And it also appears that changing implicit attitudes is not just as easy as changing your mind. Even though you may have changed, you may have learned a bunch of new things and changed your attitudes, it's more difficult to change those residual implicit attitudes, even when you've made significant changes in your explicit attitudes. So when they're different, what we find is two different things. One is that your explicit attitudes, your stated attitudes that are available to you, are much more predictive of your actual behavior when you're consciously aware of your... So we say the right things, we act the right way, but our implicit attitudes will guide our unconscious behavior. Things like nonverbal communication, things like the distance that we stand from people, things that we don't control consciously, very often our implicit attitudes towards groups will leak out in those kinds of more unconscious behaviors as well. So implicit attitudes play a role in our behavior as well. I'm going to propose that there is perhaps the exciting thing is that not only has social psychology through a variety of different experimental and research techniques been able to demonstrate the nature of prejudice, modern prejudice, There also, our research provides perhaps some solutions. So I'm going to spend my last 5 or 3 minutes telling you about what I think are our best hope for some solutions to the more modern forms of prejudice. One, I think, comes in our understanding of rhetoric and what I call the three levels of inclusion. We very often hear people say that we want to have a tolerant society. I think that's a minimal. That's pretty minimalistic. I don't know if about you, but when people say, "Oh yeah, Steve, I tolerate you," I'm not very happy. I'm hoping for a little better than being tolerated. And I think that's true of our society as well. The tolerance is a minimal position. It really says what we do is we allow you to be here, which really doesn't seem to be exactly what we should be shooting for. The next level might be people say we have to accept differences. Well, I think that's a big step forward. I think that's a really valuable thing. And there's good evidence to show that people that endorse an acceptance orientation do a lot better in terms of these prejudiced attitudes and so on. But there's still something about acceptance that says we let you into our club to play our games. Acceptance implies that the rules of the game have been established and you can play, but you're not going to change things. So you can be a full participation in our activities. I think that's, again, maybe not where we want to end. And an area which I've done a bunch of research on is what I think is the sort of third and perhaps the best perspective that we can take. And this is what I'm going to call the inclusion of other in the self. Here, this is an orientation that says rather than accepting people, what we do is by interacting and creating relationships between people, we change the nature of ourselves. Rather than accepting who they are, we change who we are because of our experiences of interacting and developing relationships. So much of my research has gone on. I'm going to pass through this one because it takes too long, but it's nice fancy graphics. Much of my research has focused on what I'm going to call the special role of friendships. And if you'll ignore, please, the gratuitous use of my own daughter in my film, my slideshow here. I think there's something very special about close personal relationships and how those close personal relationships can produce what I'm calling inclusion of other in the self. And we've got evidence from both experiments, from longitudinal studies now, from a variety of work with kids as well as with adults, college-age adults as well, to show that friendship is particularly successful at producing this process that I'm calling inclusion of the other in the self. It appears that the development of friendships across groups can be a particularly powerful tool, and the process is one that I think is really quite important. Rather than simply learning to like someone else or learning that those people aren't as bad as we thought they were, which is what people used to think that contact used to do, we think that it's much more important than that. That what actually happens is when we form relationships with other people, research on interpersonal relations shows that one of the things that happens is we actually include those people in ourselves. So that people that are close to us, we have this illusion that they are in fact part of us. You may have had this experience if you have a close partner or even a family member where something that they've done and you take credit for it, without even thinking, you imagine that you've got their skills and their abilities. That you have a sense that some of their stuff is actually yours and you forgot who said something in a conversation. Was it me or was it her? Was it me or was it him? We tend to see ourselves as overlapping. Well, that's precisely what I'm talking about in this context of including other in the self. We start to see ourselves as having the resources and identities and the perspectives of the other person that we share this relationship with. But if this is a cross-group relationship, if it's a relationship across ethnic groups, for example, one of the things that new relationship gives us access to, one of those things that we can include in ourselves, is the other person's ethnic identity. And when the friendship is close enough, people actually come to feel connected to that other ethnic group in meaningful psychological ways, that the self becomes associated with and connected with that outgroup. And that act of connecting the self to the outgroup, of course the person knows full well they're not a member, right? You know, I do a lot of research in the north with Inuit populations, and I've been going there for 20 years. I have many, many friends up there. Many of the feelings that I talk about in these kind of talks, I feel towards that group. I feel like I'm personally connected with the people of northern Quebec. But obviously, if anybody grabs you by the shirt and says, "Steve, you're not Inuit," I go, "Of course I'm not Inuit. I'm not Inuit at all. I'm not even vaguely Inuit." But nonetheless, I feel very much attached to that group. The struggles of that group feel like that they're important to me. And that's the essence of this inclusion of other in the self. When you feel like the struggles of that group are your struggles. You know they're not, but you feel like they are. When you feel their accomplishments are somehow something you should be proud of, you shouldn't, but you do, you feel like you should, then we're talking about inclusion of other in the self. And it appears like one of the best ways, or at least the best way that we've been able to find to create that connectedness, that sense that the other group's experience is relevant to yours, is through these close group friendships that people create between groups. And at that point, the person can then, at that point, the person can't hold more negative views. It would be inconsistent. If that group is relevant to me and I'm a good person, it's inconsistent for me to then think negative thoughts about them. And the inconsistency in those thoughts is what drives the changes, even in our most automatic kinds of responses. So, if you wanted a fancy model of what happens, there's you, the self. You're connected now to a friend from another group. You become aware of that other group membership, and somehow through that friend, you become connected to that group. And in response to that connection, your attitudes towards the group changes. So it's changing the nature of the self. It's changing who you are that produces the more positive attitudes. Rather than changing something about them, or rather than changing something about what you think about them first, what you do is you get connected to that group in a meaningful way, and that brings your attitudes in line with that positive association with the group. An understanding of prejudice that psychology can provide, or that social psychology can provide, points out that prejudice is more than simply holding negative beliefs about the other group. It's more than simply acting upon those negative beliefs when we talk about discrimination. Prejudice is often hidden from the people around us because we know it's not socially acceptable. It's often subtle. It comes out in ways that don't even sometimes look like prejudice until you look really hard. And it's sometimes even unconscious. We're unaware of our prejudice attitudes, even though they exist, and they are there, and they leak out in important nonverbal ways. Findings from social psychology: these findings may feel alarming and disappointing to those of us who want to believe that we're not prejudiced. I think most people find it very disturbing to go onto that website and find out how strongly they associate positive things with their own group and negative things with the other group. And it should be disturbing to us. But it should also remind us that even though we think we've come a long way as a society and as an individual in changing our attitudes about groups, it's not good enough to just stop saying the bad stuff. We have to keep working at it. We have to try and generate more positive relationships through what I'm going to call the inclusion of other in the self. One of the solutions that I think is most promising involves the inclusion of other in the self, so that the individual's self and our societies even are changed by the meaningful connections that we have with other groups. So we should be proud of the accomplishments of our society if we improve our attitudes generally towards groups, as we build a more harmonious society. But we shouldn't be willing to accept tolerance. We shouldn't be happy with acceptance. We should be seeking to include at both the group level and the individual level the other in the self, so that we're changed by our interactions with others. And through those changes, our attitudes just fall in line. Let's worry less about what we think and more about how we relate and our relationships with others, because the thinking will come along on its own if the relationships develop strongly and importantly. Thanks very much.